Girls Gone Wild with Thando Mthondi on Trans Africa Radio.
It is 2 minutes past 6 p.m. Central African time. And just as promised, we have our wonderful Thuli Sibego in studio. And if you're wondering who she is, she's an entrepreneur, a philanthropist, an MC, and a speaker. She's the founder of TS Management Consultancy, co-founder of Girls Events Tomorrow, the founder of the Next Gen Leadership, and a director at the Ideology Agency. Hello, Thuli.
Hey, hey, hey.
So we just had like a fat chat, okay? So if you hear us breathing heavily, know that we had like a fat chat.
Yeah, we almost had like an interview before the interview.
Basically. How was your weekend? How are you today?
Fantastic. Great. Mm. Weekend was a bit slow, but it was good. You can see that the year, we're all starting to wind down.
Yeah. Honestly, it's that year
I'm on my last straight. Yeah. I'm like this. I'm almost there. I can do it. I can make it. Yes.
And how is entrepreneurship treating you?
Sure.
Yeah.
It's rough. Mm. Like I always say to people, you know, it's beautiful in the sense that there's so much flexibility, there's so much freedom, but it's rough, guys. Mm. Entrepreneurship is very, very rough. People, you know, think entrepreneurship is glamorous, everything about it is amazing, and you get to do all these amazing, like, it's amazing, but, you know, there's those struggles that we as entrepreneurs face on a daily basis, you know? The biggest one is cash flow.
Cash flow,
cash is king. Like I always say to people, if you don't have cash in your business, you don't have a business. Yeah. And that's just the reality of where we are, you know, as entrepreneurs right now. The economy is slow, companies are not paying like they used to. Mm-hmm. It's a struggle. It's a real struggle. But you know, I wouldn't trade it for anything. Mm-hmm. I think for me, it's having been on this journey for the past 10, 11 years. It's for me has, I've grown a lot, you know, and I do things differently, and it's really opened up my eyes to an amazing world. So I'm pretty blessed, and I'm very grateful for where I am.
So let's talk about you as a young woman deciding that this is the way you'd go. You finish your studies, and do you get a job? Did you start off working?
Yeah, so sure, my journey has been very, very interesting. I wanted to be an accountant.
Oh, me too.
I think there's a lot of us who are like, I want to be an accountant. Yeah. Then you get in, then you're like,
not so much.
I'm not so sure about these numbers. Anyway, so I started off, I wanted to be an accountant. I studied accounting for 2 years. I did it for 2 years. After the second year, I was like, no, guys, hey, I'm not about this. Mm-hmm. Something was missing. Like, you know, when you're missing the fire, when you're studying, but you're studying because you're ticking off the boxes, and you're ticking off the boxes because your parents.
Yeah, and you promised that you would.
You know, you had the deal with your parents to say, I'll do this thing, but deep down inside, you actually don't want it. So what I did is I then decided that, you know, this is not working for me. I'm going to drop out of school, and then I started working. So I worked at a call center. I did midnight shift. We used to call it the graveyard shift. Ooh. So I used to work 3 to 11 in the evenings, because I think at that time I was trying to figure out what I really wanted to do with myself, where I wanted to go. So I wasn't sure where, you know, what I really wanted to do. And also, I mean, you must understand, when you're a black child, sometimes you have the challenges where your parents cannot pay for your fees anymore, you know. So there's all those struggles, and that's what happened with me ultimately. I think that's one of the reasons why I even gave up on becoming an accountant. So I worked, I started figuring out what I really wanted to do. I left the first company I worked for, went to another company. And I think for me, when I went to the second company, I decided that I wanted more stability. You know, okay. I wanted an 8 to 5, so I can figure out what it is that I wanted to do. So I worked in client services, worked my way up, moved from client services to corporate consultant. Okay. I was doing pretty well, you know, but started right at the bottom, learning like everybody else. Got to corporate, became a corporate consultant. I loved it. It was really awesome because you meet different corporates and you understand how different businesses work. And you really, you know, you grow as a person. And I think for me at that point, what happened is a friend of mine from high school, she was working for an events agency. And I think we knew we wanted to work together. I mean, when we met in boarding school, we were like, you know, you and I get on very well. We have to start a company together. And I think why we said that was because both our parents, our dads were entrepreneurs, you know. So, you know, there's a bit of, you take a bit of your parents when you become older. So both our parents were business people. So we knew we wanted to be like our dads because we were daddy's girls, proper daddy's girls. So fast forward to then, worked, served my due, and then I was like, before I jump ship, let me see if this accounting thing is really, I don't want to do it.
Okay.
I just had to be 100% sure, you know. So I went and worked for an engineering firm, and I did project accounting, and I was working with a project accountant and the accountant. And I knew, like, my soul was just
dying.
I hated going to
work.
Is this
when you wake up in the morning, you're just like, I can't believe I'm going here again.
It was awful. It was absolutely awful. Like, I learned a lot, don't get me wrong. Like, I always, for me, I always use every experience as a learning opportunity. You know, I think everything happens for a reason, and it's to prepare you for whatever it is that you're going to become later in life. And I think that's what I did. You know, I learned, and an amazing opportunity came within the company itself. The marketing lady was doing, starting to do conferences within the business unit, and I was like, I'm keen, I'm interested, let me join, you know. So then I started working both my job, mm-hmm. and I worked in the marketing department, mm-hmm. because for me it was just about learning. I didn't care about the money. It was just, I'm here to learn and get as much as possible. Learned the job, understood how to run events, and then an opportunity came for my friend and I to start our own business. One of the clients she knew were looking for an agency. They're looking for a young, fresh team. They wanted to empower young people. And we went, we pitched for the job, and the rest is history. Mm. You know, we got our first client. And I think for me, you know, going back to when we started, like I always say to people 11 years ago, it was so much easier. You know, it was, I think for me, when I jumped ship, it was, I had to negotiate with my parents. Mm-hmm. I had to literally say to them, okay, I understand. Here I'm getting a proper salary. I've got benefits. Mm-hmm. Life is great. Yeah. And, you know, and you are happy for me. Mm-hmm. But I need to do something for me, mm-hmm. you know. And I sat down with my mom. My mom was like, what's your plan? What's your 5-year plan? What's your short term, long term plan? If this thing doesn't work, what are you going to do about it? Mm. So we sat down, we drafted, you know, we literally, like, and she was supportive, and she was supportive because she had to. She wasn't supportive because
it was her first choice.
Yeah. You know, she just said, you know what, you've made the decision. I can't change your mind. Let's see how I can support you as much as possible. They supported us. I mean, I remember when my family was so funny, because back then I moved back home. My car was paid off, so it was easy. Okay. It was so simple. So debts wise, it was literally a simple move. And I remember how when we started our business, we did everything ourselves. Like, we used to gift wrap. Like, I'd come home with gifts from clients, and my car was full. And we literally had an assembly line with my family, my sisters, amazing. And my brothers, and we'd sit and we'd put everything. I'm like, okay, right, I have 200 gifts that I need to package for an event tomorrow. Everybody works. So in the evening, my family would start packing, would do an assembly line. So it's things like that you're like, wow, we've come a long way.
That's love. love.
Yes.
Pure love.
Yeah, you know, yeah. And I think I'm grateful for that opportunity, because my parents they could see that, you know, we're actually working. We're not just saying we are entrepreneurs and we're not really doing anything, mm-hmm. but they could see the returns, they could see that the company was growing, they could see that we're getting clients. Mm-hmm. And I think also because we were young, and we were, you know, young people are very creative. Young mm-hmm. people find different ways to
How
do
old
different
is young?
Things. I was 26.
Okay.
I was 26.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think then it's, you know, you're not afraid of anything. You know, you challenge the status quo. And I think that's why a lot of older people then bought into us. You know, they really didn't buy into the business. They bought into us and our passion. You know, we used to work late hours. I didn't sleep, because, you know, when it's your own business, mm-hmm. you hardly sleep.
Yeah.
And then the business started growing. And I think for me, you know, I always wanted to create a business that had a social element to it, because yes. I always felt that we have a responsibility as entrepreneurs or business people to pay it forward, you know, because I think without our businesses, how are we then supposed to empower young people?
Absolutely.
You know, so if we've got the tools and you've got the opportunity within your organization, let young people come work, you know. So what we did then, we decided to create our whole, we had young people come work for us. So we'd hire interns. Get them to come work and do the horrible work, yeah. the horrible stuff that we did yeah. at home. Got them to learn the business, got them to understand the art of working, got them to learn how to work basic computers, so that when they go and apply for a job, they've got the experience, you know, because a lot of young people, the battle that they had then was, do you have experience?
Yes.
And how do you ask somebody if they've got an experience when they've just come out of school?
Yeah.
You know, so I always battled with that question, because mm-hmm. I was asked the questions in interviews. So what's your experience? And you're like, come on, lady. Like,
girl, you know I ain't got no experience.
You know what I'm saying? So that's what we wanted to do with our agency. We wanted to create an agency that, you know, had a social purpose. You know, it wasn't just about the profit. Yes, we want to make money like any business. But I think for us, we were, you know, social purpose driven for young, empowering other young people, and also paying it forward. You know, and I think that's how I was raised. I mean, I was raised by a community of amazing women. You know, I grew up in the best of time, where kids were kids. You know, we played in the streets. Mm-hmm. We were surrounded by amazing women. We had lots of role models. My mother wasn't just my role model. The lady down the road, Umama next door, was a role model, mm-hmm. because she was a single mother working, feeding her family, you know, and there were fathers who were entrepreneurs. So we were surrounded by so many amazing brains. This is in Soweto, because I grew up in Soweto. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of amazing things that we were exposed to. So our world was completely different to the world now.
Yeah.
You know, and I always say to my husband, when we talk about just kids and how we were gonna raise kids, I'm like, things are different. You can't compare our childhood to the childhood that these, like, that what's happening right mm. now. So that's what we did. We got young people to come work with us. And the business grew, and we knew we'd never wanted a big company. We always wanted to manage it. Okay. You know, we wanted to have a business so that's manageable, but still doing, you know, still doing good, still, you know, still going out, getting clients. And yeah, fast forward to now, I think what I, like last year for me, I knew I'd outgrown my business.
Oh, you know,
yeah, I knew I'd outgrown my business. I love what I do. I love putting things together. I love running events, but I felt I had a bigger purpose. Mm-hmm. You know, there was that thing inside me that was calling me to serve, you know, and I think that's where the whole idea of Girls Invent Tomorrow came about.
Yes.
You know, so Girls Invent Tomorrow was literally, I was at an event, mm-hmm. quite a few events, because I used to do, most of my clients, strange enough, were in technology. It was big tech companies. Mm-hmm. And I used to sit at events and I'm like, where are the women in technology? Guys, what's happening? Mm-hmm. And I'd ask the few women that were there, I'd ask them, I'm like, guys, what's going on in this industry? Yeah. Why don't we have female representation? Every time we're at these events, it's men, there's one of you. Like, can somebody please explain to me, you know, what it is? Went and interviewed quite a few of, you know, the women that I knew, and they were like, no, Tuli, it's technology, it's very male dominated, it's driven by men. I'm like, I'm going to change that.
Yeah.
I'm going to find a way. I don't know how. I'm going to find a way. Mm-hmm. And my sister-in-law, she's in tech. So we then came up with this idea to start this Girls Invent Tomorrow, where we expose young girls to technology. Mm-hmm. Because when we started doing research, just from a South African context, never mind global, mm-hmm. we started seeing that there's so many amazing women in technology.
Oh, amazing.
So many amazing women. We want to share their story. We want other young people like me when I was young, mm-hmm. to see that, oh yeah, so this is a career I can potentially go into.
Yeah.
You know, and technology is so big.
Yeah.
You know, there's so many platforms within the tech space. So I think it was all about just finding the right synergy for us in terms of the Girls Invent Tomorrow. And that's what we did. You know, we started with just career workshops. You know, we'd go to schools, we'd do career workshops with girls. And a lot of the girls, when we show them just technology and what careers they can do in technology, a lot of them were like, new world opened.
Yeah.
And you were like, wow, this is so amazing. It's so nice to see young people being open to what's out there. Mm. And we knew we basically knew we'd opened Pandora's box and we couldn't go back.
Yeah.
So we started then, you know, speaking to some of our clients to say, please sponsor some of our events. We want to do coding workshops. We want to do training workshops. There's a number of things that we do within Girls Invent Tomorrow. And yeah, we were very fortunate that a lot of our clients were, you know, they were very welcome to the idea.
Open to it.
And
yeah.
I think they saw the vision that we had, you know, and they sponsored us. They came on board. We were given machines by one of our other clients for free.
Amazing.
You know, so it kind of worked out. Mm. During all that, the Girls Invent Tomorrow, like, my brain is constantly working. I'm constantly looking for opportunities with everything that I do. Mm. And while I'm busy doing that, I started looking at my team, the girls that work with me. Mm. And I was like, I need to start something for young people. I think young people need to have their own event that talks about young people, talk about the issues that they have, young people to empower young people. And that's how Next Gen was born. Mm. You know, we literally came brainstorm with my team, and they were like, we love the idea, Tuli. Can we run with it? I'm like, let's go for it.
Yeah.
And Next Gen was born.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much, you know, where I am in terms of just my, you know, me and the steps that I took to get to where I am today. And currently, obviously, now I'm in transition. I call it I'm in transition. I went back to school.
Okay.
I went to Gibbs. I decided that I needed a year to study social entrepreneurship and kind of get to understand what it really entails. Now that I've decided that's a journey that I want to take.
Yeah.
You know, because I always feel that we always need to, you know, knowledge is power. You always need to upskill yourself as a person, especially if you want to speak a certain language and you want to do a certain thing. So for me, it was something like I felt I'm talking social entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. I need the knowledge that comes with becoming a social entrepreneur. So I went to Gibbs, studied this year. I've been studying this year, the whole year. And I'm loving what it's done in terms of just opening my mind in terms of how we strategically, how Girls Invent Tomorrow and Next Gen are going to be rolling out in the next year or so.
That's,
you know, and which is why for me, I, you know, the business, I loved Anglo, it was great, but it served its purpose.
Mm.
You know, and now I've kind of gone out on my own. I've got a consultancy business, mm-hmm. and I do CSI strategies now.
Oh,
and I run my two NPOs, Girls Invent Tomorrow and Next Gen, and that's pretty much where I'm at.
And Tuli, tell me about this the audacity to keep going. Like you say, from when you started out as an entrepreneur to where entrepreneurship is now, it really has been also a very rocky kind of... When South Africa started talking about entrepreneurship, we had no idea what it would look like, but we knew we needed it, right?
Yeah.
And so today, you've really made strides, but just the audacity to keep going. Was there ever a time you're just like, job's 24.
Yes.
I'm going back. I can't do this. Was there ever a time?
There were lots, lots and lots and lots. Mm. But you know, for me, what kept me going was my family.
Mm.
The support, the people that I surrounded myself with. Like I always say to people, surround yourself with people who've got the best interest in heart and people who want to see you succeed. You will succeed. Mm. You know, there were days when I'd wake up and I'm like, yo, this is not working for me. I need to clean up my CV. I need to go back to employment.
Peanut.
And start working. Yeah,
sit.
You know, like clean. And just see what's out there. And it's so weird. Like I believe that some things send you get, you know, you get directed as a person. I'd wake up in the morning, for instance, and a client would call and would say, I need X, Y, and Z. And I'm like, is this a sign or am I being delusional? Then you start questioning those things.
You're like, Tuli, you're overthinking it.
Yeah. You're overthinking it. And also just when you get feedback from your own family, you know, your own family is like, we're so proud of you. You've done so well. You made us so proud. And then you're like, okay, so I can't let people down. I need to keep going, you know. But in the same token, I was always very realistic in terms of just when I knew it was time for me to call it quits.
Yeah.
You know, I always went in, even now, I mean, I've gone into this consultancy business and I'm doing what I'm trying to do with the business itself. But I've got a thing in the back of my mind to say, if things don't work out, I'm okay with cleaning my CV and going back and looking for work and just trying to kind of, you know, because things are, the economy right now is very, very hectic. You know, it's very, very tough. But I think for me, if it wasn't for my family, and then, I mean, when I met my husband, who was my boyfriend then, and his family, and my friends, you know, I've got an amazing group of sisters. Like, we call each other, like, we are inseparable.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I'm blessed that I'm surrounded by people who just, you know, we root for each other. Mm. We always, when somebody's doing well, we're like, we've got your back, you've got this. And that's what people need. You need to know that you're not alone in this journey, because entrepreneurship is hard,
yeah.
You know, and the support structure is part of whether or not you succeed. You know, I mean, there were times when we didn't have money in the business. Sam and I didn't, like, we had no money in the business. And we literally had to, like, you're gonna phone your dad, I'm gonna phone my dad. And but you have to have that. Mm-hmm. If you don't have that, unfortunately, you know,
it
becomes difficult. And a lot of people end up having to shut doors and having to, you know, make the decision and closing their businesses. But it is that. It's just having the right support structure and having the right people supporting you, mm-hmm. you know, because not everybody wants you to succeed.
Yeah.
Don't forget that. You know, as much as you are running this journey, you're running this race, and it's your race. You know, like I always say to people, we all have our own different races to run.
Mm.
I'm running my race, somebody else's race is different, and I'm happy for them, but I've got my own journey to run. Not everybody is happy, and not everybody is rooting for you.
That's crazy.
So you always have to remember that, but keep going. Mm. There will be distractions, there will be people who are going to want to bring you down, there will be bad, I mean, I've had the roughest times, mm. you know, but for me, I get up, you know, dress up and show up.
Yeah.
And that's it. You know, when the days when you just really don't want to go see clients, you don't want to see anybody. But at the end of the day, those are the people that are going to pay the bills.
Yeah.
So those are the people that are going to, you know.
And it's up to you. Only up to
it's
you.
Only up to
Nobody's
you.
Coming no, to save
exactly.
you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it was really that for me. It was just support structure.
Now, Tuli, you speak about your husband. I think this is very important. As young women, consider entrepreneurship. It's something that I'm thinking about a lot right now. Finding a partner, okay, who is going to empower your dreams? Because honestly, the wrong part, if you had married at the wrong man, you would be nowhere really, because your partner can completely crush your dreams.
Absolutely.
They really can. How would you say your husband he supports, just your romantic partner, the person that you choose as a life partner, has really directly contributed to your success?
Sure. My husband was, he's like my number one fan.
Mm-hmm.
He really, I'm so lucky. Like there are times when I look at him and I'm like, how did I end up with such an immature person? Because my husband has always been the, I think it's also from how he grew up, you know, with
That's
his parents.
Important.
It's his background. But he's always believed that I've got such a big purpose And for him to hinder that would be doing community a disservice. Mm-hmm. You know, so, and how I met my husband, you know, we met through a common project when we were 19.
Wow.
We ran a Saturday school where we taught kids in the township math, science, and English. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, you attract the people who have the same, who say the same vision as you. And I think when I met him, I was like, wow, he's such an interesting character, and same vice versa. But I think the why we work so well was, when we were still, when we were young, when we were 19, still finishing out of school, figuring out ourselves, we had a common purpose, a purpose that we cannot let young kids get left behind. And we were still young kids ourselves. You know? So I think it was, it started with that. And even when we started talking about our dreams, where we see ourselves in the next 5 years or 10 years, it was always about, babe, where are you going? How can I support your dreams? Because I can see you are an entrepreneur. You are that person that, and you go out and get that stuff. How can I best support your dreams so that I don't hold you back? And I was lucky in a sense that he was the one who kind of drove me in the right direction. And he was the one that when times were tough, you know, I was like, you do know you're not alone. You know, the times when you don't even, I'd never even talk to him about the problems we're having in the business. And I'd sit and I'd feel sorry for myself.
Yeah.
And, you know, he'd literally say, babe, it's a partnership. Tell me where I can help you. How can I support you? Where do you need help? Maybe I know people who can help you. Talk to me. So it's just being able to talk about it and being able to kind of root for each other and support each other through the journey. And that's what he did for me ultimately. You know, he really just was about, let's see how far this thing goes. Let's support it as much as he can. But we also need to be realistic. If it doesn't work out, we need to clean your CV and go and work. You know, and that's really what it was. It was just finding a person with a common dream, a common vision, and supporting throughout.
Yeah. Now the reason that the topic for today, I guess, would have been a topic, and I don't like topics because they put me in a direction that sometimes I don't want to go. But you specifically work with young women.
Yes.
And that's something that many people might question.
Yeah.
Right? And you don't really owe anyone an explanation for it, to be honest.
Yeah.
But in empowering young women, how are you finding it to be effective without involving men? Are we involving men? I think it's important that for as long as the resources are with the men, we need to have them as allies, right?
Absolutely.
So is there that sort of thinking in the business that, well, the men need to come to the table too? How are you projecting that?
I think for me, I as much as I'm woman, pro woman, and I'm empowering young girls and all those great things, we need those men to be part of the conversation, to be part of the topics. We are not raising or women or men on their own.
Yeah.
These women that we are nurturing, the girls that I'm nurturing, they have boyfriends and all this stuff. They're going to be part of the journey. So if we are not nurturing the men at the same time as nurturing the women, we're going to have a problem.
Which is
what we are having now. The social problems that we're having, where men think they own women, the way they treat women, and it's just it's innate in the DNA, the way men just think they own you as property. So for me, I think with GIT, yes, as much as we are pro-woman and we about women empowerment and all those great things, we also feel that men need to be part of the conversation.
Yeah.
You know, they've been through it, they understand it, but they need to allow us to set our own agenda. Do you know what I'm saying? Because sometimes we find that men will want to be there, but they want to set their agenda for you. But let us set our own agenda, because we do things differently.
Yeah.
The way we run our businesses, the way we do things, ours is completely different. Mm. And you see how with a lot of women-owned businesses are always about the people.
Yeah.
You know, it's completely different
to men.
Some of the men.
Well, it's bottom line.
All of them. It's some of the men.
Yeah.
You know, for us, it's about a community. You know, like they always say, if you empower a child, she empowers the nation. Mm-hmm. It is true. That's what we, and I think for us, it was, let's empower these young girls. Let's give them hope. Because I think for me, you know, when somebody comes to you and says, how can I help you in your career? How can I help you get to where you want to get? I'll mentor you. I'll support you where I can. But you also need to own it, because that's another thing that gets blurred. You know, young people always sometimes feel that we owe them, you know, the fact that we have to empower them, you know. You need to own it, you know. So for us, it's really just, let women set their agenda. Let women decide how they want to roll out things with the way they want to roll out things, but with the support of
the men.
Of the men.
Yeah.
You know, we can't do things on our own. That's just the reality of our things. The skills, let them share the skills with us. Let them empower us. And I think that's why with some of my projects, you will see, I mean, if you see some of my images, when we ran our coding workshop, mm-hmm. We had, it was 12 learners. Mm-hmm. We really just ran because we're keeping minimum. But we had three guys in the class, mm-hmm. you know, because we cannot get, they can't,
you can't say
behind.
No.
Exactly.
You can't say no, you and can't that, come.
Those are the questions we used to get asked. But what about the boys? Mm-hmm. And then I was like, okay, so what about the boys? So then for me, it was easy because I was like, babe, people are asking me, what about the boys? Mm-hmm. Can you then be part of the boys' agenda? Because I know you and I are driven by the same thing. Okay. So whatever you do, you kind of bring them in and you move together, because mm-hmm. at the end of the day, as much as we're trying to change inequality, we're trying to put the woman's voice forward, mm-hmm. These men that we're leaving behind start becoming wanting to own us and the prop and
you threat, see it. A threat to the success,
really. and they are threatened. Mm. The reality is, you know, the status quo is changing slowly but surely. Yes, we still don't have a voice of certain things, and it's slow. Mm-hmm. It's the change is slow, but
it's there.
Men are threatened by what they are seeing in terms of just women and, you know, married women who are now the breadwinners. You find that in couples, in relationships, women are becoming the breadwinners because things have changed. You know,
and it's gonna shake you. It's really gonna shake the way society
it has already. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I always say to my learners, I'm like, great, do well, but don't be arrogant about it. Mm. You know, bring your partner in, involve him in anything that you do, because I think that's a part that fundamentally is also could be missing. Because you look at how we are raised by our mothers, mm-hmm. and how our mothers ran the household. You might not think so when we're growing up.
Yeah.
But if I look at our household and how our household ran very well, but my mother ran it. Mm-hmm. My mother was the one who was in charge. My dad was, yes, he was the breadwinner. He was the one who was entrepreneurial. He was the one that brought the money. But when it came to fundamental principles of raising your child, raising your kids to be good human beings, to understand what other human beings are about, to just be a good person in society, she was the one that ran it, mm-hmm. you know. So that's just the reality that how I try to teach my kids to kind of say, yes, be the one in the forefront, mm-hmm. but don't forget the other people. Don't be have a partnership. Have a discussion with your partner about how you're going to do it.
Yeah, and so you work with children, literally from different walks of life.
Absolutely.
How are you distancing yourselves from their real problems? Because I know this is something that I've spoken to quite when I speak to people who work with children. They just talk about how. Some of the stories you hear are literally heartbreaking, and sometimes you can take that home, mm-hmm. and it can really affect you mentally, emotionally, spiritually. How are you managing to not take every child that you meet home with you, to essentially affect your life and your space?
To be quite honest, you can't. Mm. You know, once you've seen how other people are living and how other people are going through difficult times, challenges and stuff, you're never the same. And I think that's why for me, when we did community youth empowerment when I was 19, you know, I was exposed to all of that then. My life changed completely. So I knew that I cannot live in this world and run the society where I'm just driven by me and making money and being rich and all those things. I can't, because I've seen what other people are going through. So it shapes you completely. And it's hard because, you know, you go to whatever community you go to, you are involved, you are part of it, the kids tell you a story. Then you go to your house, you go to an awesome environment when you're sitting there, and then you're sitting there and you're like, but how did this world get like this? You question those things. I mean, we sit and we question it all the time. Mm-hmm. Then there's a sense of guilt. You're like, sure, I feel very guilty about the fact that here I am, and this is for me. It's I go there and I'm smiling, then I go and I tick boxes and stuff. But that's somebody else's reality. They go back to that reality all the time. But I think how I survive it is I'm always about, when we go to those communities, we need to make sure that we help them with the tools and resources to change the communities that they live in. Because the important thing is, we need to help the communities to help themselves. You know, that people need to be given the tools to help themselves. Yeah. Because if you don't help themselves and we go there and we're like, you bring whatever you bring, then you get out. Then you're not helping them.
You're creating a very dangerous culture.
Expectation. Mm. And that's the me generation that you are going to do this, you're going to do that. But if you skill them with the basics, and you also make them understand that they're not alone, you know, it's a community of other people that are involved, then you kind of, you start seeing the progress. It's slow. Look, it's slow. I mean, I'm nowhere near where I would wish I would have been in terms of the stuff that I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. But I'm not going to be hard on myself on it. I will still continue on my journey and trying to change and shape people's lives. But I think it's your life is never the same.
Yeah.
You know, once you experience and you see what other people are, well, let me for me, mm-hmm. my life is never, it's never the same. I feel guilty. I do. I feel guilty. And I feel guilty of the small things. You know, you go out for lunch or dinner. You come back. You're driving, traffic lights. There's a person there and you've just had this big meal and you're like, ish. You're like, <Yeah. laughs> okay. But what else can you do? Because yeah. that's, you know, so you try not to own it, but be aware. Just the fact that you are aware, it kind of ignites something in you yeah. as well. And your life will never be the same.
I think it's something important that social entrepreneurs need to also know, is because when you're a social entrepreneur, you really are about the impact, yeah. right? But you kind of have to know that you're not God in it,
yes,
right?
That's such a good point.
That as powerful as you are in the empowerment process, it's not always up to you, and you can't help everyone and everything.
That is very true.
Do you know what I'm saying?
That is very true.
I mean, the few social entrepreneurs that I have met, they like I said, there's that guilt, but there's that depression of, am I doing enough? And it's almost like, oh, you're crazy. You're doing a lot.
Yeah,
you know? Yeah. But that guilt is, I think it's middle class guilt, and most African people who have managed to leave the township or leave very difficult circumstances and maybe move to a suburb and drive a decent car, and they feel it. We all feel it.
Yeah. You know, start a career thing within your community where you once a month or once every 2 months, whatever your resources allow you to do, mm-hmm. where you bring other people to come on board and come and talk about careers or whatever it is that you do. Because I'm finding now there's so many people, my friends, who are like, Tuli, how can we help?
Yeah.
Where do we help you? Please tell. And I'm like, guys, wait. Just let me strategically figure out what I'm doing first before you. But it's amazing. I'm humbled by the amount of people, even women in technology, with this Girls Invent Tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I have so many incredible women mentors who have all put their hand up. They're like, Tuli, where can we help? How can we help you grow this thing? How can we be part of the conversation? How can, call us. Whenever you want us to go to the communities, call us. But also in the same token, I'm very protective of who I allow into the space of the kids. Yes, because I do not want once-offs where people come in, ooh, we shine tick boxes, you post wherever, and then that's it. You know, there has to be longevity,
yeah,
all the projects that are sustainability, and that's
yeah.
what social entrepreneurship is about.
Yeah.
About sustaining whatever it is that you do, you have to be able to sustain it.
Mm.
And I think that's why for me it was very important for me to take the gap year off, to kind of say, okay, I'm going to take this year off and really strategically now think, how am I going to create projects that are going to sustain themselves, that are going to outlive me, mm-hmm. that when somebody comes in they can just pick up and say, okay, how are we then moving forward?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what it is. It's all good and well that we all want to help, we all want to raise our hands, and we all, but you know, sometimes it's not just about the once off, it's about the consistency. Kids believe in the consistency and the fact that, oh wow, every once a month, every 2 months, these people are coming to a community, they're helping us grow, they're helping us with our CVs, they're helping us with basic typing skills, because that's what people actually need. It's not the big things that we're all trying to do.
Yeah,
kids want basics. I mean, when we started, we thought the girls that we were impacting and the communities we're impacting were about coding. We want to code because globally everybody was talking
code,
let's
yeah.
code, let's code, let's code. Then we got to meet our learners. The girl child that we got exposed to was completely different. The girl child we got exposed to was learning technology at school, but theory, like textbook. They had textbooks. They had never seen a computer.
Oh, wow.
They were even scared to switch it on. You know, so we had to completely change our strategy. Say, okay, so coding will be part of it.
Yeah, we'll get
at a
there.
Later stage.
Mm-hmm.
But let's let these kids have a simple, like a Gmail address. I mean, when we did our Gmail addresses with our learners, they were so excited. Then they start sending you emails. Then you're like, okay, now I have to respond to these emails. Because for them, it's a new world. We've opened up a whole new world to them. Then they see what they can do with the technology amongst themselves.
Mm.
Then you kind of say to them, okay, do something amongst yourself. Don't just get excited that you've got technology. Like, technology is such an powerful, important tool. Let's help kids use it to teach each other,
yeah.
you know. And that's why, for me, I love the space that I'm in terms of technology, mm-hmm. the fact that we've gone into that space. I'm loving the opportunities that are out there. They're endless.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to empower people to empower themselves.
Yeah.
And that's key.
Yeah, and when you talk about tech, I find tech to be very intimidating.
Yeah.
You know, like, this, the thought of it, I'm just like, oof. You know, and even coding, it's just like, oof. You know, as somebody who didn't go to school for it, how did you find, I think, the courage to speak about it and sound credible and be credible? Because it's tricky.
Yeah.
It's very tricky. You know, tech people know very well that what they do is very niche,
yeah.
right? It's very niche. And lots of people just don't have the natural understanding of what it really is that they do. I mean, how did you manage to get the buy-in of the tech world and to manage to transfer it to children in the townships?
Yeah.
Confidently, without looking like, hey, this one doesn't know what she's doing.
It's learning.
Yeah.
Learning. You must, you know, as a human being, you must be teachable. And I think that's one of the, for me, I'm so grateful. My mom, you know, my mother was very on the, you must be teachable as a person, mm-hmm. and you must be willing to, you must open your world and be willing to learn. That's what I did. Mm-hmm. You know, tech was something that I grew up with. Mm-hmm. I was those girls that played video games. I was that girl. Mm-hmm. But you see, going back to what I'm saying, that there was no role models that I could mold myself around to say, oh, I can pursue a career in technology. I love gaming. I can make a career out of gaming. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that was possible.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why mentorship and role models are so important, especially in the communities that we come from. Because if you see somebody who looks like you, who's got a similar background to you, it becomes, starts becoming real that I can achieve that. Yeah. I can attain that. It's somebody that's got a similar, you know, background and a similar story. Mm-hmm. So that's why for me, when I do my woman in tech and I invite them to schools, I try and pick those women that have walked the journey, that are similar, so that the kids can see that, you know what, if you are willing to learn and if you're willing to be teachable, anything is possible. Mm. You know, the world is so big now. I mean, young people have got, like, literally the world is opened up so many opportunities. Mm-hmm. And if I was young now, I promise you my life would be completely different. My life would be, sure, I'd be flying, you know, because for me, I see what's out there. I see what's been given, but you have to go and fight for it as well, because there's so many people wanting to make success of their lives. So it's also up to you, you know, to kind of want it, to kind of, and there must be a drive, and people buy into your drive and your passion. And I think for us, GIT is part of who we are, and I think that's why it's easy for people to buy into what we want to do. Mm-hmm. You know, because we live it, we breathe it, we are the ones that are teachable. You know, I'm teaching myself how to code. You know, I've literally literally in the evenings I'm teaching myself how to code, because I want to be able to speak the language. I want to be able to be in a situation when I'm sitting in a room, if my learners or if some of my teachers don't pitch, I can then pick up the subject and learn.
Yeah.
Because I'm open to learning. Yeah. I'm open to new opportunities. And that's what it's all about. So for me, technology was, yes, it was there. I grew up loving it. I grew up wanting it, but I never put the two together. I never knew I could make a career out of it, because for me, my background was either going to be an accountant, a lawyer,
doctor.
Or a doctor. You know, our careers were kind of picked for us, you know. And now when I look at how my life has evolved, and also meeting my husband, his whole family is in tech.
Wow.
So it's almost like my life was kind of like, meeting him was part of my journey.
Yeah. But
meeting him and being surrounded by a family that breathes, lives tech. I mean, my father-in-law, the stuff that he's done in technology, he ran a school back when people didn't run school, where he was teaching kids technology. You know, so your surroundings are part and parcel of where you want to get, you know, as a person. I think for me, that's what it's been about. It's just being open and being willing to learn.
Alrighty, +27792544329. Send through your WhatsApps, any questions, any comments you have for Tuli. I'll read them live on air. Also on Twitter at TransAfrica872 or at Tando_Mtondi. I'm going to give you Ms. Cosmo with Connect 10 when we return. More with Tuli.
This is TransAfrica Radio.
Mr. Runtown himself with Mad Over You, an absolutely romantic one. If you can even hear the lyrics, because I know the lyrics are a bit kind of, I don't know, but you can't hear them clearly. That's the thing. You can't hear them clearly, but it's a good song. It's a romantic song. And if you listen really hard, you'll realize how romantic African men can actually be. 6:49 p.m. Central African time. We are in studio with Tuli Sibego. And I have a WhatsApp message here. And she says, hi, Tando. Awesome show. Please ask your guest how old she is. You guys like to ask questions. Doesn't matter. Also, if you were listening, you can actually calculate.
If you were listening,
you can actually do the math.
Do the math.
Quick maths. Very quick maths. And also, please ask her what advice she gives to young women who are trying to become entrepreneurs today. Alrighty.
Yes. That question. For me, it's about, first of all, you need to have a plan of what it is and where you want to go in terms of your entrepreneurship journey, and do a lot of research and work at it. You know, just work at it and read. And, you know, because things change all the time. You know, whatever industry it is that you're in a year's time, it would have changed to become something else. But also go into it for the right reasons. You know, because a lot of us, like everybody now is talking entrepreneurship. Everybody must be an entrepreneur. Everybody must be an entrepreneur. But yes, if we're all entrepreneurs, who's going to work with entrepreneurs? Do you understand what I'm saying?
100%.
And I think we all need to know where our strength lie and be honest with that. Be honest with where our strength. And there's nothing wrong with working in a corporate and really making it and affecting change. I want to say affect change wherever you are. But I think literally entrepreneurship is about just you literally it's like getting off a plane and jumping and then building your plane as you're about to get down.
Yeah.
That's what entrepreneurship
and
is
hoping
about.
You don't land.
And hoping you don't land because it changes all the time. Mm. But if you've planned, look, plans change sometimes and you get derailed and you lose focus. But if it's all about just having the right direction and getting into the right reasons and being passionate about what you do. Because if you love what you do, waking up in the morning or sleeping at midnight or sleeping at 3,
it's nothing
to you. You know. So yeah.
What would you say is the right reason? I mean, hating your boss is not a good enough reason to quit your job and become an entrepreneur. But what would you say is a sound reason?
I think if you've got a good product and you've got a good whatever it is that you're selling, and you can see the numbers. It's also about the numbers as well, because numbers don't lie. Mm-hmm. You know, ultimately numbers don't lie. And if you've got a good business plan, you know, if you can see that the business plan is can take you and can grow the business, then go ahead and do it. But I think it's very personal. Hey? Like the entrepreneurship journey is personal, because for me, the person that's selling tomatoes and selling is Paza Shop, that's working.
That's an entrepreneur.
That person's an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. You know, because that's what they're doing every day. They are happy earning income that they're earning, and my entrepreneurship journey is completely different. You know, I want to run a big organization, maybe. So it's a personal journey, but a sound business plan with an exit strategy. You know, because things happen. You know, you get swayed. You get recessions while you are in the midst of running your corporate. And how do you then survive the recession? You know, things like that happen all the time. Mm-hmm. And also, being an entrepreneur, you need resilience. You know, you have to be resilient, because There are good times, and don't get me wrong, the good times are amazing. You know, when your business is working and things are working, clients are paying, and things are just are going according to plan, it's the best time you could ever ask for. But you need to be resilient, you know, because it changes all the time, constantly. Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, in South Africa specifically, and maybe the other parts of Africa, I wonder, that we have a way of glamorizing entrepreneurship. We really glamorize it. And I mean, I've seen lots of little memes of, yes, while you build somebody else's dream, I'm building mine. Yeah. Great. It's awesome. Yeah. Right. But it really is not that rosy. Besides cash flow, what are some of the other layers? I've heard people say it's lonely. Mm. I've heard people say because it's all you, it's straining.
Yeah.
But what are some of the challenges that you face as an entrepreneur that people just don't talk about, but they are there?
Sometimes people don't wish you well, you know, because it's almost you are living their dream, or you are living what they could have achieved. There's always that, you know. It's so sad that as a nation, you know, you look at how the Jewish community, how they run and how they run their businesses and how they support each other and they buy from each other. And the reason why they are such a successful nation is because of that, you know. And then you come to us as African people. We work in silos. We all want to achieve whatever we're achieving, but on our own. And we're not going to go far if that's how we're going to work. It's about growing the network within each other. We talk it. I've been in this industry, like on my own, for a long time, mm-hmm. and everybody, we talk the talk. Everybody's like, "Yeah, we must support each other. Twili, we must support you. We'll give you business. Yeah, we'll give you business." You know, when I started my business, I think I had over 10 friends who were marketing managers. More like I knew people in marketing, and everybody knew what I did. They knew my business, but not one person gave me a business. I got my business from my acquaintances from school, high school.
Wow.
People I went to high school with. People who are like, "Oh, we like what you're doing." Like strangers, completely different. From men in boardrooms. You're sitting in a boardroom with different people, and they ask you, "So what do you do?" "No, I run my own business." "Come meet my whoever, so and so. Let's see how we can help you." But the business that I got never came from the people that I know.
How are those relationships now? Because it's, I mean, it's kind of personal, but you know, it's kind of personal, but you don't want to be that person either. You don't want to be angry and bitter and so on.
Yeah.
How do you go around? Because it's your friends who will ask you for discounts. It's your friends who will not pay you on time.
Absolutely.
You know, it's your friends that will give you some of your headaches.
Absolutely.
How are those relationships now?
I've always been, I think, you know, people are people. People have got their own weaknesses. They've got their own issues. I'm not going to let them stop me from wanting to achieve what I want to achieve. And that's the key. You know, just keep moving. Keep, you know, there'll always be somebody who's going to believe in your dream, believe in what you're doing, and support you in your business. But also, you must deliver. You know, because there's one thing, we all say we're entrepreneurs and we want to do stuff and we want to run our own businesses. But also, let's deliver. You know, let's do the work. Let's show people that we can actually run our own businesses, and professionally too. You know, let's be professional entrepreneurs, because sometimes I find, you know, like for me, for instance, because I use a lot of I use photographers, I use caterers, I use different people at different times, because I'm about empowerment. I'm so about empowerment. You know, there's those moments when you decide, okay, I'm going to give this person a chance. Let's see what happens. Yo. And then they just let you down.
Yo.
And then you're like, yo, when your photographer doesn't arrive, the event starts at like 7 and they arrive at like 7:30 or 8 and you're like, yo, guys, but can we just be professional?
Yeah, you can know, we
like,
show up for each other?
Let's just be professional. Mm. And it's not the big things. It's just time, showing up on time. Mm-hmm. If something starts at 7, get there early. So you know the scene, you understand the situation, you understand where things are going to be. That's it. And let's be professional in our businesses. And I always find that we should change our businesses, you know. If you've got a company, speak it. You've got a business, be proud of the business, you know. Even if you're just selling basic t-shirts and stuff, it's still a business. You're still running a business. So for me, it's always been, you know, those people who don't support me, it's about them at the end of the day. I'm on a journey. I'm trying to achieve what I need to achieve because I've got a bigger purpose. I've got other people that I need to service. That's their thing, you know. It's disappointing. Mm-hmm. It is like there are days when I'm like, can you believe this person didn't, like, can you believe it, you know? But I think it's human beings, you know. Human beings will always have their own issues that you can never explain, but don't let people stop you from achieving your dreams.
Now we are about to wrap up the interview. We have 2.5 minutes left. If there's anything that you want people to say about Thuli after, long after she's gone, what would it be?
It's just being, oh, that's such a difficult question, but I think I managed to give people the resources, and I empowered people to have a voice, you know, to change their lives, to journey on forward without me, because it's all good and well where we're saying that you want to empower people, but you actually don't empower them, you disempower them. But for me, I just want, you know, you, like I said, your life is a message to the world. Make it inspiring, you know. I want to inspire people to believe that they can achieve it, that the journey is hard, but never give up on anything that you want to achieve. And that's pretty much, yeah, what I'd love people to think of me.
All right. So now on Trans Africa Radio, we have $1 million question. And that question is, on Trans Africa Radio, we play 100% African music and we bring the world 100% African content. What do you think about that?
I think it's incredible. I absolutely think it's fantastic. I think, you know, Africa is booming. You know, you and I had this discussion earlier before offline to say, Africa is where everything is. We've got the resources, we've got the minerals. So you guys are doing an incredible thing, and high five to you. I'm so proud of it. And it's such an honor to be here today and sharing my story and sharing my journey. And yeah, I think let's have our own voice.
Yeah.
You know, let's speak our own language. Let's tell our own stories. Mm-hmm. And for me, this platform is incredible.
All right. And Thuli, if anyone wants to find you, reach you, give you business, give you funding, give you headaches, where can they find you?
I'm
on social media?
I'm very active on social media. Mm-hmm. Twitter specifically, at Thulilo is my Twitter handle. And all my details are there. It's the quickest way that I can reach you. And email, I know some people want email. It's thuli.sebeko@me.com.
All right. And that is how we wrap this one up.
This is Trans Africa Radio.